Today we talk about the zeta function, so we start with a curve C, smooth projective curve defined over a finite field FQ, and we have considered the numbers NN, which is the number of FQ rational points of degree 1 of C, so that is this number, and we look at DN. That was the number of effective divisors of degree N. And we also looked at pi N, which was the number of places of degree N. Defined over FQ, of course. And we looked at a generating function, which is zeta c t, which was defined as the sum over n of n greater than or equal to zero, of course, dn t to the power n. That is the zeta function of our curve over fq. And we have seen that it allows a product over all places, 1 minus t to the power degree of p, and this to the power minus 1. As you have seen, a similar Euler product you have seen for the Riemann zeta function. And we have also seen yesterday that it can be written as so zeta ct can also be written as exp of sum n greater than or equal to 1, nn t to the n over n. So that is the other way of writing it, which connects the dn with the nn. And we have seen, for example, in case that c is the projective line over fq, then we have seen that the zeta function of c is equal to 1 minus 1 divided by 1 minus t, 1 minus qt. Okay, so that is the beginning, and now we want to understand this zeta function better, and for this we will look at the zeta function of the curve also over extension fields. So we have our curve C defined over FQ, but I can also consider it as a curve defined over extension fields of FQ. So if F is the function field of C over FQ, then I have a function field Fn, which is the field which I obtain by allowing as constants all elements from FQ to the n.
Excuse me, could I please ask a question? How is big n depends on the index n?
How does it depend on what?
On index. The
axis
is small.
Oh, sorry, here there is a mistake. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. So we are looking at the curve over an extension field, and we have seen that if P is a place of degree n on C over FQ, then a place Q of Fn, so that is a place, that is a P is a place of F, a place Q of Fn lying over it has degree. Well, if this is degree d, I better say, the degree d divided by the greatest common divisor of d and n. as we have seen, and which I also gave as an exercise yesterday, and we have seen that there are greatest common divisors, D and N, such Q lying over it. Okay, so that gives a connection between points or places of the curve over FQ and over extension fields. And so what we can do now, we can also look at the zeta function, zeta n c t. Well, this is the zeta function of, I might say, fn, of, I can say, of c viewed as a curve over fq to the n. Right? That is also something that we can do. And the question is, what is the relation between these two zeta functions? And so the proposition is that zeta n of c t, but I replace it by t to the n, that this is equal to the product over all nth roots of unity, so over all zeta in the complex numbers, which satisfy zeta to the n is equal to 1, z c zeta t. This is the statement, and so this is what we will prove now. So for this, we look at this zeta n of c t to the n. Well, if I use this Euler product, then you see that this is a product over all that q, let's say, places of fn. So these are the places of fn. And then I have 1 minus t n, and then I get the degree of q to the power minus 1. But of course I can take them together, and I can write this as a product over all p, the places of f, and then I take the product over all q lying over p, and then I have 1 minus t to n times the degree of p, the degree of q minus 1. And this, of course, we can rewrite using what I said over there. So we can rewrite this as the product. Yeah, so I need an identity which so given two numbers d and n, and let's say so then the identity that I need is x to the power n divided by the greatest common divisor of d and n minus 1 to the power greatest common divisor of d and n. This is equal to the product x minus zeta to the power d, where the product is over all zeta with zeta to the power n is equal to 1. So this is an identity in the polynomial ring, which I leave for you as an exercise. You just look at the roots of both sides and conclude somehow that they are the same. Okay, so let's rewrite this again. I guess I can erase this. Okay, so what do we get here? So if I take this out, then you see that this product over Q over P, 1 minus T to the n degree of Q, inverse, say, this is the same as the product over 1 minus T n times d prime, where d prime is the degree now, which is equal to d, let's say here d prime is this, and so how often do they occur? Well, they occur with the greatest common divisor, so greatest common divisor of d and n times, and with the minus sign. And now I apply my identity, and you see that this is the same as the product of 1 minus zeta t to the power d to the minus 1, and you take the product over all zeta to such that zeta to the power n is equal to 1. Okay, so that is what you obtain from the identity on the board on the left hand, and so left hand side, and so we can rewrite this now by plugging this in. I rewrite this, and so I find that the zeta function is the product over all zeta, such that zeta to the power n is equal to 1, and then the product over all p places of f, so of the curve over fq, and then I get 1 minus zeta t to the power the degree of p, to the power minus 1, and this you see is the same as the product of our zeta c zeta t, where the product is over all zeta, such that zeta to the n is equal to 1. So that is the proof of this this identity. So we see a relation between the zeta function over an extension field and the original zeta function that we have. Okay, so we are counting in the zeta function, we are counting the number of effective divisors of degree n for varying n. And so we are looking at a group, namely the divisors on C. Well, we divisors are formal sums, some NPP, so I can formally add them and subtract them, so they form an abelian group. And for clarity, I might add here FQ, because I want that everything is defined over FQ, but in order not to burn the to have too heavy notation, I will often omit it. But so this is the group of divisors on C. And we have seen that for a divisor we have a degree. So we have a map from the divisors on C, the degree to the integers. And so, I mean, we can look at, we can write this as a disjoint union of the divisors of a given degree. Maybe D is better. So, disjoint union over all D. Well, of course, the divisors, these are the divisors of degree D, given degree. And we have seen an important role is played by the divisors of functions, and these are called, so say P, script P is the subgroup of principal divisors. These are the divisors of functions. So these are the divisors of all f with f in the function field not equal to zero, right? And they form a subgroup. And we also know that the degree of a divisor of a function is zero. So we can consider the quotient group, the divisors on C, modulo this subgroup of principal divisors. And so that is a group which we call the Picard group of C. And you could write it as PIC, P-I-C, of C. Well, maybe better add this additional information that we consider everything over FQ. But so we could write PIC C FQ if you wish. So this is the group of divisors on C defined over FQ. Modulo the divisors, also maybe I should say over FQ, but so these are the divisors defined over FQ of functions in the function field. And we know that we have this degree map, and the degree of a principal divisor, of a divisor of a function, is zero. So the degree map is still defined on this quotient group. So it's an abelian group, and the degree map is still defined. And so we might ask, what is the image . Well, the image will be an ideal in Z, a subgroup, and so it will be generated by an element. And so we say that this delta zero generates the image. So delta zero will be positive. Let's assume that it is positive, and that is the this is the image of the degree map. In other words, we are asking what degrees of divisors do occur on a curve. And for that, so before we address that question, I will make first claim, namely the proposition is that we can look at this, but since this decomposes in cosets here, also this will decompose in cosets, so we can look at the divisor of degree n on C modulo linear equivalence. That is also what I could say, modulo linear equivalence. So these are the cosets there. And so the proposition is that if D is an effective divisor of degree n, we get a bijection pick 0 C pick n C. Me recall, we have this space L of D for a divisor D, and yesterday I also introduced the projective space that belongs to it, namely all D divisors which are effective and such that D prime is linearly equivalent to D, which means that the difference of these two divisors, D prime and D, is the divisor of a function. So these are the effective divisors, and this can be identified with the projectivized space of L of D. Right? So that is a projective space. Okay, so how many elements are there in there? So we are counting effective divisors. So you see that this is important to know the cardinality of this space. And so if L of D is the dimension of capital L of D, you see that the number of elements of this projective space, number of divisors which are effective and linearly equivalent to D, well, that is the number of elements in this projective space. Well, how do you get the projective space? Well, you take the vector space that has Q to the, we are working over FQ, LD elements. We remove the origin and we divide by the action by the non-zero scalars. So that is the number of elements in this projective space. So that is what we do. Okay, and so now we can draw a conclusion with this H, this number that I introduced. Namely, you see that if apply Riemann-Roch. So let me do it explicitly. Let me recall, we have Riemann-Roch, which says L of D minus LK minus D is the degree of D plus 1 minus G. G is the genus. And now if D is a divisor, so if the degree of D is greater than 2G minus 2, which is the degree of the canonical divisor, as we saw yesterday, well, then K minus D will be a divisor which has negative degree. So this will be, then this is zero, right? If the degree of D is greater than that, then it follows that we get a zero there. So then Riemann-Roch is very good, because then Riemann-Roch gives the answer to the question, how many functions are there, or how many effective divisors are there? You see, if we can calculate the dimension of this space, I can calculate this number, and then we know how many effective divisors there are linearly equivalent to a given divisors. Okay, so if this degree is true, then you see that L of D, so I mean that the number of elements in this space is equal to Q. Well, what is then this? This is the degree of D. So that is, if the degree is n, we are indexing by n, then it's Q plus n minus G minus 1 divided by Q minus 1. This is the number for every divisor, but we have to count how many divisors up to linear equivalence. So in order to find this dn, if n is larger than 2g minus 2, you see we have just to multiply by the number of classes that we have, right? For each class, we count how many effective divisors there are in that class, so we get h times q n plus 1 minus g minus 1 divided by q minus 1 if n is greater than 2g minus 2. So we have calculated this number using just Riemann-Roch if the degree is large enough, right? Okay, so now we start calculating the zeta function. Okay, so the zeta function, so that is zeta of ct. Well, I mean, I can apply this only if the degree is large enough. So we will have a sum where the cases are a bit difficult, n is 0 to 2g minus 2. And then I have dn t to the n. I cannot do much at the moment. But then you see, I get a sum. Let me first write it. N is e to infinity, and then I get d n delta 0 times t to the power delta 0, because I only know that the degrees that occur, they are multiples of delta 0, right? That was the image of the on the degree map of the group of divisors. And so I know this, and what is e? E is such that e times delta 0 is the smallest integer greater than 2g minus 2, right? So that I can apply my calculation. So that is the thing, and the point is that I can calculate this now. So with this I write as, some polynomial here plus something which I can calculate explicitly, and I get h divided by q minus 1. So let me take this out. It's h divided by q minus 1, and then I get a sum over all n from e to infinity q to the power n plus n times delta 0 plus 1 minus g minus 1 times t to the power n times delta 0, right? So that is just what I get by substituting the calculation that I did. If the degree is larger than 2g minus 2, then I can calculate by Riemann-Roch how many effective divisors there are in a given class, and I know how many classes there are. So this is the answer. Okay, so this is already quite good, because if you look at this series, you see that we can write it as if you just take this, forget the restriction here, you see that you can write this and up to some polynomial as a geometric series. So what we get is that this is some polynomial in t divided by 1 minus t to the power delta 0 and 1 minus qt to the power delta 0. Okay, and so we see, for example, that it converges for t in absolute value less than 1 over q. And we can write it, if you wish, as L of t, some polynomial, divided by 1 minus t to the power delta 0, 1 minus qt to the power delta 0. Okay, so you see it become pressing to really find out what this delta 0 is. And that's what we are going to find out now. Okay. Yeah, so let me also remark here that we know the zeta function, well, it is defined as some dn t to the n, and these dn are non-negative numbers, and infinitely many of them are non-zero. So you see that zct diverges for t is equal to 1, yes, because infinitely many coefficients are greater than or equal to 1, right? Okay, so now the answer to the question of the delta 0. So the proposition is that delta 0 is 1. So let's prove this. Well, so recall that I have this formula here. So if we look at the zeta function of the curve over an extension field, I know what it is. So what we do is we now take n equal to delta 0. Take n equal to delta 0. Okay. So what can we say about zeta? First, a remark about zeta. Zeta ct, well, this is a sum of d, but every n that occurs here is a multiple of delta 0. So I write m times delta 0 t to m times delta 0. And here the sum is now over m, right? Okay, so you see that if I plug in a root of unity, zeta t, then I get the same zeta function as long as zeta delta 0, zeta to the power delta 0 is equal to 1, right? If zeta satisfies that, then the zeta function will be unchanged. Okay, good. And now I look at, let me use this blackboard. Now I look at zeta function over fq to the power delta 0. So then I have zeta delta 0 c to the power t to the power delta 0. This is the product of zeta c zeta t, where zeta delta 0 is equal to 1, right? That was this formula in this special case. But these are all the same, so you see that this is the product of zeta c t, sorry, this is just this to the power delta 0, right? That is the way of writing. Okay, but this thing, if I look at zeta delta 0 c t, this is the zeta function of c viewed as a curve over fq to the power delta 0. But we have seen that this has a pole of order 1. The zeta function has a pole of order 1 at t is equal to 1, right? Because we have a 1 minus t, and it occurs just once here. And we know it is not cancelled by this polynomial, because I said it diverges for t is equal to 1. So there is a pole of order 1. So this has a pole of order 1, pole of order 1 at t is 1. But then you see that if I replace this t by t to the power delta 0, it still has a pole of order 1, right? Because if you have something like 1 t minus 1 or 1 minus t, and I replace this by t, then it just splits with roots of unity, and there is only one factor, 1 minus t, right? So it still so this has a c delta 0, c t delta 0 has a pole of order 1 at t is equal to 1. Yeah, but on the other hand, this zeta ct also has a pole of order 1, and this makes that it has a pole of order delta 0. So, the only conclusion is that delta 0 must be equal to 1. Right? Everybody agrees? Okay, very good, because then this simplifies. And so we will do the calculation again now. Okay, so what is this zeta ct? What is it? Well, we are summing over divisor classes. And as I said, so there is the beginning where we do not know too much. So I cannot say too much, except that, I erased it. So we will have q to the ld minus 1 divided by q minus 1, effective divisors linearly equivalent to a given d. And so I do this for each class delta or d in the divisors, in pick n of c, where n is less than or equal to 2g minus 2. Right, that is this beginning, times t to the degree of d, of course, plus, okay, and the rest we have calculated now that we also know this. So we get h for each class, we get the same number, so that is q to the power n is 2g minus 1 to infinity, q to the n plus 1 minus g minus 1 divided by q minus 1, and then of course I have t to the n. That is what we have by separating this and this. Okay, so let me multiply with q minus 1. So what do we get? Well, I get this, so that is a sum d, and of course the degree of d is less than 2g minus 2, and then I have q to the ld times t degree of d, plus, well, I have a 1, but I do this for every class, so I get a minus sign, of course, minus h times t to the n. And I sum this from n is 0 to 2g minus 2, plus, okay, and now I do the other terms. Okay, so what do we get? We get here plus h times q to the 1 minus g times the sum n is 2g minus 1 to infinity, q to the n, t to the n, minus h times sum n is 2g minus 1 to infinity, h I already have, t to the n. That is what we get, and I can rewrite this as sum, let me write this, as sum q to the ld t to the power degree of d, where the degree of, so the sum is now over the classes, yes, but the class is d, and so the degree is less than or equal to 2g minus 2, and of course greater than or equal to 0, plus, oh my god, so this is a bit, plus, I continue on another board because I want to display this formula. So we take terms together there, and I find this is the sum over d, so that the degree of d is greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 2g minus 2, q to the ld, t to the degree of d, plus h times, and then I take the things together, q to the power g, t to the power 2g minus 1, divided by 1 minus qt, and then I have minus 1 minus 1 minus t. Well, maybe you have to stare 2 minutes to see that this is really the same as what we have there, but that is not difficult to see, and that is what we get. And now you see, well, this is a sort of troubling part, but the rest is very clear, and it also shows a remarkable symmetry here. You see these two terms, and this remarkable symmetry translates in the the functional equation for our zeta function. And it says the following theorem, the zeta ct is equal to q to the power g minus 1, g is the genus, t to the power 2g minus 2, zeta, and then I have c 1 over qt. That is the functional equation that we find. I mean, we have to prove it, but you see that this is just the symmetry that you observe between these two terms is expressed by this formula. Just substitute and you will see, if I did it correctly, that this is the right form. Okay, so you see here there is this symmetry. Symmetry. Okay, which takes into account this functional equation for that part. So in order to prove it, we only have to see that this part also satisfies the same symmetry, right? If we do that, then we are done. So let's prove it. Okay, well, so we need to see only symmetry of the first part. Okay, and this is what is given to us by Riemann Roch again, because, well, we just write it out. So we have the sum from n is 0 to 2g minus 2, and then I have t to the n, and then I have the sum over all divisor classes d, where of course the degree is n now. Degree d is equal to n. And then I have q to the power l of d. Okay, but we know the theorem of Riemann-Roch, so let me take this little piece of script paper to write it. L of d minus l of k minus d is degree of d plus 1 minus g, and I'm just going to substitute this for this L of d, and so you see that you get the sum t to the n, and then you get the sum of q to the l k minus d plus n plus 1 minus g. And so if I now substitute this again, so where is the eraser? So I can write this as a sum of q to the power g minus 1 t t to the power 2g minus 2, sum over divisor classes d, where the degree is in our range. And then I get q to the power lk minus d times 1 over qt to the power degree of k minus d. But we know the degree of the canonical divisor. It is 2g minus 2. So if you just substitute it, I can write it down, but q to the power g minus 1, t to the power 2g minus 2. It's a sum over, and now I just put d prime is k minus d. And you see that then I sum over d prime, classes d prime, and the degree again is in the same range. And so what you get is q to the L of d prime. If I just use this Riemann-Roch now, you see that you get the q of L d prime 1 over qt to the power, the degree of, I should try this better, the degree of d prime. But now I call my d prime d, and then I'm done, right? So you see also this part satisfies this same symmetry, which is sort of encoded in this formula by just calling this my d, and then this is the k minus d. And so since the degree of the canonical divisor is 2g minus 2, we remain in the same interval for the degree, and we find this functional equation for the zeta function. So let me reformulate it. So that it becomes more in line with what you saw for the Riemann zeta function. Namely, let me, reformulation. So let us define for our curve another zeta function like this. And it is depends on the variable s. And then I just substitute for t, I substitute q to the power minus s. And then you see that you have the equation that zeta of c s, if I just translate the equation over there, you see that you get this is q to the, 2s minus 1 times 2g times g minus 1. And then I have here the zeta c 1 minus s. So even you could define a function psi, which is defined of c of s, which is defined as q to the power 1 minus g times s times zeta c s. And then you can work out that functional equation translates just in this functional equation. And now it really looks like what you saw for the Riemann zeta function with or without its gamma factors. You see it is very, very similar, right? And we have proved now the functional equation of the zeta function. And so next time we will try to harvest results from this, because we know it is the generating function for the number of effective divisors, but we have also seen that it is related to the generating function for the number of rational points over extension fields fq to the n of the field over which we are working. So next time we will see how we can deduce results, how many points a curve has over extension fields if we know the zeta function, yes, and we will see how to calculate it. Are there any questions? No? Then, okay, then thank you.
This will be a little bit of a